JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for September the 30th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar continued trading lower against the majority of the other G10 currencies on Tuesday and during the Asian morning Wednesday. It gained only versus the Canadian dollar, the pound, and the pound, while it was found virtually unchanged against the Japanese yen. The main gainers against the greenback were SEK, the euro, and the Aussie in that order. The relative weakness of the dollar and the yen, combined with the strengthening of the Aussie, suggests that financial markets continue trading in a risk-on fashion. However, turning our gaze to the equity world, we see that major EU and US indices were a sea of red, with investors' appetite improving somewhat during the Asian session today. Although Japan's Nikkei 225 and China's Shanghai composite slid 1.58 and 0.46% respectively, Hong Kong's Hang Seng and South Korea's KOSPI are currently up 0.29 and 0.86%. It seems that after Monday's rally, EU and US traders may have decided to lock some profits ahead of the first debate between the presidential candidates Donald Trump and Joe Biden. The debate did not move the needle in betting markets, as there was no clear winner, and as a result the financial markets did not react. The two frontrunners battled over Trump's response to the coronavirus pandemic, the economy, and taxes, with the discussion marked by multiple interruptions and aggressive personal attacks. The improvement in the broader sentiment during the Asian session was not the result of the debate, rather of data suggesting that the Chinese economic recovery is well on track. The nation's official manufacturing PMI rose to 51.5 from 51, beating estimates of a more moderate increase to 51.2, while the non-manufacturing index increased to 55.9 from 55.2. There was no forecast for the non-manufacturing index. With all that in mind, even if equities continue to recover somewhat following China's encouraging data, we remain reluctant to call for a long-lasting recovery. Coronavirus infections continue to rise at a fast pace around the globe, while as we get closer to the US election day, markets may begin to be more responsive to headlines, debates, and polls on that front. Generally, a Trump re-election may be positive for the equity world, as the incumbent president is likely to keep the 2017 corporate tax cuts in place, while Biden has pledged to increase taxes in corporations and high-income individuals. According to national polls, Biden is leading Trump by 50% to 43%. Now back to the currencies. The euro was among the main gainers against the greenback, with its traders perhaps waiting for the preliminary Eurozone inflation data for September due out today. The headline rate is forecast to have held steady at minus 0.2% year over year, while no forecast is available for the core one. That said, the HICP excluding food and energy metric is expected to have accelerated to 1.1% year over year from 0.6%. Bearing in mind that both the German CPI and the HICP rates slid by more than anticipated, entering negative waters, we see the risks surrounding the bloc's headline rate as tilted to the downside. At the prior ECB meeting, policymakers kept monetary policy unchanged, reiterating that they stand ready to adjust all their instruments as appropriate to ensure that inflation moves towards its aim in a sustained manner. Following the worse than expected PMIs for September, with the services sector slipping into contraction, a further decline of the headline CPI into the negative territory may increase speculation for additional stimulus by the ECB. However, the fact that the core HICP rate is expected to have accelerated means that the weak headline CPI rate may be the result of declines in energy and food, which may allow policymakers to wait for a while more before they decide to push the easing button. They may prefer to wait and see whether the deflationary rate is something temporary or not. As for the euro, it could slide in case the headline CPI slides further and the HICP print misses its estimates. However, the opposite may be true if the core HICP metric accelerates more than forecasted, despite the headline CPI rate staying negative. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the early European morning, we already got the UK's final GDP for the second quarter, which revealed an upside revision to -19.8% quarter over quarter from -20.4%. Later from the US, we get the ADP employment report for September. The forecast suggests that the private sector has gained 605,000 jobs after adding 428,000 in August. This may raise speculation that the NFPs due out on Friday may come slightly below their own forecast, which is at 875K. That said, we repeat for the umpteenth time that the ADP number is far from a reliable predictor of the NFP print. Even last month, when the ADP revealed 428,000 additional jobs, the NFP came in at 1.027 million. The final GDP for the second quarter and pending home sales for August are also coming out. The final GDP is expected to confirm its second estimate, while pending home sales are forecast to have slowed to 3.2% month over month from 5.9%. From Canada, we get the monthly GDP for July, which is expected to reveal a slowdown to 3% from 6.5% month over month. However, this would still be a historically strong monthly rate, which combined with the little change CPIs for the month of August, is very likely to allow Bank of Canada policymakers to sit comfortably to the sidelines for a while more. At their latest meeting, they kept policy unchanged, reiterating that they stand ready to adjust their programs if market conditions change. With regards to the energy market, we get the Energy Information Administration report on crude oil inventories for last week, and the forecast points to 1.569 million increase after a 1.639 million decline the week before. However, bearing in mind that yesterday the API report revealed a 0.831 million slide, we would consider the risks surrounding the Energy Information Administration forecast as tilted to the downside. As for tonight, during the Asian session Thursday, Chinese markets will be closed due to the mid-autumn festival. In Japan, the Tankan survey for the third quarter is due to be released. Both the large manufacturers and non-manufacturers indices are forecast to have risen to minus 23 and minus 9 from minus 34 and minus 17 respectively. We also have five speakers on today's agenda, and those are ECB President Christine Lagarde, ECB Chief Economist Philip Lane, Bank of England Chief Economist Andy Haldane, Minneapolis Fed President Neil Kashkari, and Fed Board Governor Michelle Bowman. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.